Good evening, everyone. We are a few days before Shavuot. A few days before the acceptance of the Torah, from Pesach to Shavuot is time of preparation that we going every day one step higher all the way to the day that we receive the Torah. You may ask, 3,300 years later, what difference does it make? Back then, we felt the holiness of accepting the Torah, but today, we already have the Torah. What's the occasion, Shavuot, besides having a Yom Tov, what else? The answer is that every holiday has the same spiritual light in heaven, just like the time it happened in history. Pesach, the Exodus of Egypt, the night that we celebrate Leil HaSeder, it's the same light, the same special light that we had back then. And Shavuot, the day that we accepted the Torah, same light of the day that we accepted the Torah. So since today, we are a few days before Shavuot, I'm gonna at least start speaking about the night of Shavuot. What's special about that night? And then if we have time, then we'll speak about other things. As you all know, when Hashem came to Moshe Rabbeinu, it was a process. First, he told him you have to go to Paro and convince him to send him out of Mitzrayim. And Moshe was refusing. It took 1 week back and forth between Moshe and Hashem until he finally agreed to go. And then when he went there, it took many times, he kept going and again, and Hashem started to strike Egypt with the plagues. And we know basically how was the chronological order of the events, that at one point we arrived to Makat Bechorot. That was the night that we came out of Mitzrayim, and Hashem killed all the firstborns in Mitzrayim, and we came out of Mitzrayim. Now, once we came out of Mitzrayim and the Egyptians chased us and they drowned, after that, it took 7 weeks exactly until we received the Torah. But 3 days before we got the Torah, it was special days. Hashem said to Moshe, I want you to prepare the nation, to prepare them for the special day that is going to happen. 3 days, everybody has to be holy, has to be pure, that's the correct word, to purify themselves. How do you purify yourself? Today we have, we have the Torah, we have the mitzvot, but now we are talking before the Torah was given. How do you purify yourself? So Hashem said to Moshe that the way to purify ourselves is not to have relation with the wives. For 3 days before, not to have personal contact, any intimate relationship we shouldn't have. And the question that we have to ask right away is why? Hashem say to wash all the clothes, which means to purify them. And obviously, there was a way to purify yourself. So why did we need 3 days before not to have contact with the wives? He could have said, few hours before I'm going to give you the Torah, I want everyone to go to the mikveh. You have some kind of a lake there, something. That's obviously, where you washing your clothes and you're getting water. Purify yourself over there. Why do you need not to be with the wife for 3 days before? And the answer is, after 3 days after a person was intimate with his wife, still the effect of the relationship that they had is still affecting the body of the woman, the connection that they have. Up to there, 3 days, the sperm can still make the woman impure, even though it was over, even if she washed herself, everything, whatever happened, 3 days later, after that, it can still keep her impurified. Therefore, Hashem say 3 days before, after 3 days, the seed is losing its value, is not be deserved to be called already seed. What we call, it's already losing its ability, and therefore it doesn't have the status anymore of what it was. And after that, from then on, it's no problem. By the way, I saw a research that they show that 5 days after, the sperm can still conceive a woman, can still make her pregnant. 5 days after. It doesn't contradict what the Torah say. The Torah didn't say that it cannot. Just that the Torah said that 3 days it still makes the woman impurified. But after 3 days, it doesn't make her anymore tameh. This is the story of the 3 days. It's called Shlosha Yemei Agbala. That Hashem actually puts a limit, and he told us that these 3 days we have to purify ourselves to be able to accept the Torah. However, let's read a little bit how it was from the Torah explained, and then we will we'll explain why we have to stay up all night in Shavuot and learn Torah. What's the significance of that? So, Vayishma, this is the way the Torah, it's in Parashat Yitro, Vayishma Yitro, in Parashat Yitro. There is a part in the Parashat Yitro that describes exactly how we accepted the Torah. Let's focus on some of the words, because although we read it many times, not always we pay attention. Hashem comes to Moshe, and he said, this is the way he says, if you're going to listen to me, and you keep my covenant, you're going to be a special nation to me. V'yitem li sgula. Sgula in Hebrew comes from the word mesugal. Mesugal means able to. It has special abilities that others may not have. So you're going to be a special nation to me from all the nations, because I am the master of the land. Meaning everyone is under my supervision, but from you, I expect something totally different than the Gentiles. You are special. You have abilities. You are the children of Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. You're going to be mesugal with special abilities. But that's conditional. Make no mistake here. All your abilities, it's only if you're going to listen to me, keep my covenant, then you're going to be a special nation. Meaning, if you're not listening to me, and you don't follow my covenant, not only you're not special, you are worse than the Goyim. Why? Because the Goyim, I have very little expectation from them. This is what you have to keep, 7 laws, and you're righteous. And when you die, you go to heaven of the Goyim. It's very, very easy to be a Goy, to be a righteous Goy. 6 of the 7 laws, they keep anyway. 1 of the laws is very hard, that you should not steal anything. Not even a quarter, not even a dollar. That's very difficult for everyone, not only for the Goyim. To go in your entire life without stealing almost anything, it's very, very difficult. Even a person that is very careful, sometimes accidentally may have gezel in his hand. He borrowed a book, he forgot to return, all kinds of things like that. He used someone's pen without permission, that could be, or he took someone's pen and accidentally he kept it, and then he found it at home, and he realized, wow, where will I find this person? There's all kinds of things like this may happen to a person. But it's very, very interesting. So the Goyim, if they keep the 7 laws, they go to heaven and that's it. And the Jews, they may do a lot more than the Goyim and still do not make it to heaven. And still, God forbid, cannot have a share to the world to come. Why? Depend what violations they're breaking. If they violate some of the rules, they may have some serious problems. So Hashem continue. Va'atem tiyuli mamlechet kohanim ve'goy kadosh. You're going to be a kingdom of kohanim. What do you mean a kingdom of kohanim? Kohanim means, the meaning of the word kohen is mesharet bakodesh, a servant of a holy service. A servant of Hashem. In English, the right word for that, maybe it's a priest, not Christian priest, priest in general. But this is what it means. You're going to be a kingdom of servants, of holy servants, the Goy Kadosh. And you're going to be a holy nation. Remember, this is all conditional. You're only going to be holy if you're going to keep this condition, following my covenant and keeping my mitzvot. Then you're going to be a special nation, Goy Kadosh. In Israel, the word Goy, you have all the liberals and all the anti-religion people that when they hear that somebody call a Gentile a Goy, they get angry. They look at that Chas V'Shalom like it's a bad word. But this is only pure ignorance. The word Goy, it's not a bad word. It means a nation. It means a nation. Here is an example right here that Hashem called the Jewish nation Goyim. But different kind of Goyim. Goy Kadosh, holy nation. And it could be just a nation. It could be a holy nation. That's it. It doesn't mean that a nation is something bad. It means somebody from another nation. The word Goy today in modern Hebrew, it means a non-Jew. It doesn't mean a bad word. We say in the speeches many, many times, the righteous Goyim, Goy Tzadik, we say it all the time. If Goy is a bad word, how can it be Tzadik? It's just that they like to take something against the speaker or against the religion, so they take it, presenting it wrong. In the Torah it say, you're going to be Goy Kadosh, a holy nation. And write that, after that, Moshe brings this request from Hashem to the Jewish nation, and they all answer together, Vayanu kol ha'am yachdav, Vayanu kol ha'am yachdav. What do you need to write in the Torah yachdav, meaning together? All we care about is that they all answer that they're going to do what Hashem wants. Why does it have to write to us yachdav? Yachdav means everyone together spoke. The answer is, when you have a crowd, sometimes people begin to scream. It could be from, let's say, from 1,000 people, 20 people begin to scream. And all the other 980 people, when they see 20 people started to shout, they follow them. They are called in Hebrew, nigrarim. You have gorer and you have nigrar. Gorer means you tow someone. You've pulled him after you. And he is the nigrar, he is pulled, meaning he doesn't have his own opinion. The wind is shifting him left and shifting him right. He cannot choose direction. So when he sees older brother going to some direction, he right away will run after him. Or when he sees a person run after a scene, right away he will run after him. Meaning he doesn't have his own opinion. He's always moved by other people. Most of the people in the world, that's the way they are. In Hebrew, there is an expression we say about these people, En lahem amud shidra. They don't have a spine. Meaning, when you have a spine, it balances the body. It makes the body stand straight. You are in control. You don't have a spine, you become like a piece of rubber. You don't have your own stability. That's just an expression, meaning this person is very easy to hypnotize him. As soon as you begin to talk to him, you're going to decide where he's going. This is the same way in the election in America. They brainwash the people. Everyone that speaks last is winning the polls. He's going to speak tonight and give a beautiful speech. Tomorrow morning's polls, Donald Trump is leading. Tomorrow morning, the other one would come. He is now leading. Why? Because the majority of the people, not only Americans, the majority of the people in the world, they're always influenced by the last thing they heard. Just as easy it is to influence them, it's easy to switch their mind 180 degrees in a minute. This is it. I see it all the time. Many times I spoke to people, wow, unbelievable. Okay, that's it. I'm going to start keeping mitzvot. 2 hours later, I just spoke to my brother and this, oh, he became a goy again. How is it so easy after you saw the proofs right away to go back? It shows you that these people cannot really come with their own thinking and they don't have stability. And that's why the Torah wants you to know over here, that it's not that 20% scream one thing and all the other one follow them because there was like a trend. Okay, if that's what they think, let's follow them. No, yachdav. In 1 second, everybody answer together, of course we're going to do. Everyone, with no exception. Meaning everyone agree to accept and to keep the covenant. Vayanu kol ha'am yachdav, vayamru kol asher diber Hashem naaseh. And then Moshe came and said to Hashem their answer. And then Hashem said to Moshe, I'm coming to you in a cloud, in a thick clouds. Ba'avur ishma am bedabri imach. I want the nation to listen to our conversation. Why? Why it's important that Moshe and Hashem will have to talk in front of the entire nation? Why? The answer is because many, many times after Judaism started, a fake Gentile came and started a fake religion. Christianity, Islam, Buddhism, Hinduism, Krishna, all kinds of cults and religions that were made by one individual. What's the difference between them and the Torah? They never had any conversation with God in public. Nobody ever witnessed that God gave them a mission, that he even spoke to them. The only way that people follow them is based on their story. Mary came and she claimed she had a dream. Muhammad came and he claimed that Angel Gabriel gave him the Quran. But nobody ever witnessed that. Buddha came and he claimed he saw the light. He had an enlightenment. But nobody ever witnessed it. So why the way the story begins with 50% doubt? Because no one ever witnessed it. It's a matter of belief, faith. You want to believe? Believe. You don't want to believe? It's up to you. It will never be able to be proven. Nobody can prove such thing. It's a story. Nobody ever witnessed it. But me and you, Hashem said to Moshe, I'm giving you the only religion that I have. I don't have two religions. There's no two truths. There's only one. The one divine truth that I'm giving it to you today, I'm not going to give it to you in a burning bush when you and me were alone with no witnesses. No, I could have given it to you right here with a burning bush and he'll send you to Egypt with the Torah. No, I'm not interested. I designed a beautiful show. I want everybody to hear that I'm speaking to you. I want everyone to see that I'm giving you the Torah in a public event that each one of them will witness that I gave you the Torah. Otherwise, it will never, ever be the truth. Why? It will always have a question mark. I won't be able to judge the people. How will I be able to judge the people if they die one day and they come and stand in front of me and I'm going to say to him, why you did not keep my laws? They will answer to me because I wasn't sure it's your laws. I had a 50% doubt. You want me to dedicate my whole life to this story and then in the end it was all baloney? What would I do to the person? I would have to justify it. You're right, you're not a fool. Somebody told you a story and right away you run and believe it? So here, he was in front of the entire nation. And that's when Hashem say, make them, sanctify them, tell them not to go to a woman for 3 days, let them wash their clothes and be ready in the third day. V'igbalta et ha'am, tell the nation no one is allowed to go on a mountain. Once I'm coming down on a mountain, no one is allowed to climb on a mountain, no one is allowed to touch the mountain with his hand. Even to touch the sand on the mountain or the rocks, if a person would just reach his arm into the mountain, he will be killed instantly. This is the warning. No one is allowed. Vayered Moshe min har el ha'am. Moshe went down and he came to the nation and he prepared them and they all washed their clothes and they all separated from their wives. They went into the mikveh. Everything was ready to go. And then what happened? Vayi bayom ha'shlishi, in the third day, Biyot haboker, early in the morning, Vayi kolot uvrakim, noises began, like thunders, big thunders, started to become louder and louder. Uvrakim, thunders, ve'anan, kaved, heavy clouds, al ahar, on the mountain, and a siren began. Siren. Today we call it a siren, back then they call it called shofar, a voice of a shofar. But not like when we blow the shofar in Rosh Hashanah, right away, full force. No. It started quiet. After a few minutes, a little bit louder, and louder, and louder. Try to close your eyes and imagine the event right now. Early in the morning, after anticipations for this special day, the most important moment in the history of this world is about to begin. First and last time in the history that the creator of the world agreed to come and speak in public. It never happened before. it only happened to few individuals, to Adam, to Noah, to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob. Very, very few people. That's it. You can count on one or maximum two hands how many people who had the opportunity to speak to God until that moment. And now all of a sudden millions are going to witness it. So the shofar, the voice is becoming louder and louder. Vayecherat kol ha'am. All the people started to shake from fear. What do we see over here? Today, it's illegal to scare the Jews. If the speaker says something they get nervous from, it's done. Next lecture, half of the people don't show up if he's lucky. Sometimes three quarter, right? So, when Hashem does something, he knows how he created us. And one of the ways to make us pay attention is to put fear in our heart. It's not bad. It's nothing wrong with that. Don't follow the people that say fear, it's not good. I want it love and pleasant. I want it with jokes. Enough with this nonsense. The way the Torah is described in every page, Hashem is interested that we fear Him. It says clearly, it's not my interpretation, it's simple reading. What does the Torah say? Le'ahava u'le'ira et Hashem. You have to fear God, you have to love Him, you have to fear Him. And ve'yareta me'Hashem Elokecha. You should fear me, I'm not your friend. Now I'm giving you Torah. Why I'm not giving you the Torah with flowers and music, violin and some dancers, you know, and Ashrenu Matov Chelkenu, everyone in circles, and then the Torah will calm down. Why not? Why does it have to be noise, bombs, thunders? You know, the thunders, sometimes you hear the thunders, it's breaking the windows. It's very scary. The Gemara say, לא נבראו הברקים, אלא ליישר הקמומיות שבלב. Why Hashem made such a strong thunders? What? A wake-up call. Wake up, my sons. Boom, an explosion. Oh, Hashem. כוחו וגבורתו מלא עולם. Right away, a person make bracha. It reminds him of Hashem. Imagine if Hashem would get angry at me. Look at this thunder. Right away, the fear makes a person do tshuva. Right? There's nothing wrong with that. Only today they describe it like it's something derogatory. I always say it's a great honor to be scared of Hashem. To be scared of people, no, it's not, no kavod, no nothing. But to be scared of God, it's a great honor. The more you're scared from Him, the more intelligent you are. The more smart you are. The more wise you are. The more clever you are. You name it. It's not a sign of a stupidity or foolishness. It's a sign of greatness. If a person is not afraid of God, who is he afraid of? That means he's not normal. If he's not normal, what do you expect from him? So the Torah describes how the Torah was given. Siren, shofar, very scary. Shofar makes a person, gives him goosebumps. Even today in Rosh Hashanah. You feel goosebumps all over your body when they blow the shofar. And then the floor is shaking, the ground, and the clouds, and fire all over the mountain, and explosions. Why all this? That nobody will ever, ever dare to forget that moment. This moment, I promise you, those people, they never forgot it until the day they died. And then Moshe bring them into the mountain. He warned them not to go on a mountain. Hashem came down on a mountain with fire. The Gemara say, Ledofka be'Hashem. How can you be, the Torah say you have to stick to God. How can you stick to God? God is fire that eats everything. How can you stick to fire? The answer is, don't stick literally to God. Stick to the good rabbis. By sticking to them and to the Torah, they teach you, it counts like you're stuck with Hashem together. This is what it means, Uledof Kabo, right? So it says, Har Sinai Ashan Kulo Mipnei Asher Yarad Alav Hashem Baesh. Baruch Atah Adonai, Olam Shah, Kol Nehiyah Bidvaro. Everyone is standing, And the voice of the shofar became even more and more and louder. And Hashem is calling Moshe to the mountain. What happened right now? Hashem gave the Ten Commandments to the Jewish nation. But how? He wanted to read all the Ten Commandments loud. The problem is that after he finished the second commandment, all the Jewish people started to shake. They got so scared, so they say to Hashem, to Moshe, please, please, speak to God, you yourself, go bring the Torah, we cannot handle it. It's too scary. We cannot. And then Moshe say to them, don't worry, Hashem is not here to hurt you. He's only here to test you. Here, this is what they said, Daber imanu v'nishma, you talk to us, don't make Hashem talk to us. Al yedaber imanu elokim pen namut, if God will continue to talk to us, we're about to die, from fear. Their soul came out of their body, from fear. And Moshe answered, al tirau, don't be scared. Ki lebaavor nasot etchem ba elokim, Hashem came to test you. בעבור תהיה יראתו על פניכם לבלתי תחתאו. Hashem wants his fear to be always on your face, that you should not commit any sin. From here, from what I'm reading to you in the Torah, what is the most productive way to prevent people from committing sins? What is it? No, I want to hear. Fear. That's it. What are you arguing with what God says? You know better than him? Today everyone became a specialist. Fear won't work. Fear is the only thing that works. With combined together with love, it's a wonderful combination. Yes, fear only, it's not going to work, of course. Love only, it's also not going to work. Love and fear, it's a beautiful combination. Meir, this chair was waiting for you already 2 weeks. Yeah, that's the chair you like, no? You see, nobody there to sit there after you sat there. Directly from Eretz HaKodesh, Baruch Hashem. Tov. Now, why do we have to stay up? From the story here, we don't see anything wrong, no? Not everything is written in the Torah. We also have the oral Torah. When we go to the Oral Torah, we find something shocking. Shocking. Just before we receive the Torah in the morning, the Jews went to sleep. Moshe, Yitzchak, Avram, they're snoring. In a few hours, you're supposed to get the Torah. How can you go to sleep? How to believe such thing? You know in a few hours you're going to get the Torah from God and God is going to speak to you and Moshe is preparing you. Don't touch your wife. Clean yourself. Wash your clothes. Make sure there's nothing on your clothes. And now you're going to sleep? How can it be? The adrenaline should have kept them awake for a week. Unbelievable. They went to sleep. Because they went to sleep, 3,300 years, we are not going to sleep. You understand? The night of Shavuot, to fix what they did wrong. You went to sleep in such a crucial moment. Every night in Shavuot, the day that I gave you the Torah, you'll be up all night. Now, how are you going to stay up all night? This is how it goes. This year, it's attached to Shabbat. Remember that in Israel, you have only one day Yom Tov. In America, or in the rest of the exile, you have 2 days of Yom Tov, which makes it much, much longer now. Now you have Shabbat and 2 more days. It's actually 3 days in a row like Shabbat. Although there's some differences between Shabbat and Yom Tov. In Yom Tov, there's few more things that are more lenient than Shabbat. But, it's 3 days Shabbaton, 3 days. Motzei Shabbat, this Saturday night, when we do the Avdalah, when do we do the Avdalah? Inside the Kiddush. When we actually do Kiddush for the Yom Tov, inside the Avdalah, inside the Kiddush, we have a part, if it's falling on Motzei Shabbat, this is what you have to read. Not only that, We make the Seuda of Yom Tov after the Kiddush. What do we eat? We eat meat. It's mitzvah in Yom Tov to eat meat. You eat bread, you eat meat. No problem. Then we rush to the synagogue or to the yeshiva. The faster you get there, the better it is. Why? We have a long tikkun to read. Soon I'm going to show you how they organize the special tikkun of Shavuot. And we're going to understand why. We rush to the synagogue. Better to be there before 11. You get there, you have all the way until 5 in the morning. Around 5 in the morning, they already starting to pray. 10 to 5. Something like that. So you have about 6 hours maximum to learn. It's not enough. If you see how much there is to read and to learn, it may not be enough. It can only be enough if a person is taking advantage on a night without talking, coffee, this, cigarettes, outside 10 minutes and going in and then again 10 minutes and then the thermos and coffee, and the coffee didn't come good, so he goes back home to prepare a new Turkish coffee, and then he comes and he learns half an hour and he puts his head down and then his son is giving him massage, Abba, wake up. The whole 6 hours, 15 minutes he learned. You fool. All night you're not going to sleep for 15 minutes? Read 15 minutes at home and go to sleep. Don't do us a favor. If you do it right. We have a guy from LA, more or less my age. So he said to me, I feel my soul needs to come to the yeshiva over there in Monsey. I must take a month break from this area here in LA. So he's been running after me already for 10 days. When can I order the ticket? When? So when I realized that it's really serious, because a lot of people, they talk, they get excited. But then I say, you ready to come? Yeah, if you tell me tomorrow morning I come. I order the ticket tomorrow. So I say, okay, order the ticket. But I want to tell you one thing. Come only in one condition. That when you get here, you don't waste a minute. You come to the yeshiva, you sit all day, you learn, you don't go in and out, phone calls, emails, cigarettes, coffee, in and out, going to the store, going to the shop, going here, going to the barber. If you come for that, stay in LA. If you come here for a month, I want this month to be every minute you hear it's Torah. You ready for it? No talking, no baloney, no jokes, no hi, how are you, nice to meet you, what's your name, my name, forget about this. You come for Torah, yes or no? I have to see. If I wouldn't be embarrassed, I would play, he left me a recording. I'm more ready than ever. That's called reverse psychology. Reverse psychology. If you come to a person and say, come, I'm begging you, come, you should come. He may come, but he will be with the feeling I'm doing you a favor. If you come and say to him, don't come, don't do us a favor, stay there. If you come, it's only in one condition. Otherwise, don't come. No, of course, I want to come. You understand? That's how the people are. Let's see now. In 1 week, we'll be smarter. Next Tuesday, remind me to ask me how he did in his first week. Why I'm saying it. When a teenager comes to yeshiva, besides some nonsense that he has on his cell phone, he doesn't have that much on his mind. Doesn't have businesses, meeting, people. So he can focus in the Torah after a day or two and sit learn. But when a person in this age that have businesses and people and this and meetings, he puts everything on hold for a month, it's a very hard test. Because you know what's going to happen. As soon as he learned, before he even entered the yeshiva, an emergency thing in LA. Hey, you know that? Why? The Satan is never going to let a person sit and learn Torah. So, after we see that the nation of Israel almost died from fear, and they begged Moshe Rabbeinu, please, you talk to God. We cannot take it. We're going to die. Moshe answered, don't worry. It's all a test. Hashem put fear on you to help you, not just to scare you because he's sitting there and laughing and enjoying. No, to help you not to commit a sin. So when somebody scare you and it prevents you from using drugs, he's a very good person. somebody scared you because of that, you're not eating cholesterol and you're not getting a heart attack, it's a very good doctor. If your wife tells you, if you're not going to go to shul, if you're not going to learn every day, I don't want to be married to you, just give me a get and send me free, and that's waking you up, you don't have a choice, so 7 o'clock in the morning, you're in a shul instead of snoring until midday, right? So the fear that your wife put on you, that's what saved your life. So what are you complaining? That's a very positive thing. Now, since we have to stay up all night, they organized the tikkun that we're going to learn a little bit of each. So it starts with Chumash. That's the basic of the Torah. That's the written Torah. We start the story of Bereshit, Bara Elokim, and then we go to Noach and all the parashot, little by little from each one until we come to the end of the Chumash. Not the entire Chumash, obviously. That will take you a week. Right? So, a little bit from each parasha until we finish the Chumash. What comes after? Right after the Chumash is finished, we go into Nevi'im. Tanakh, Torah, Nevi'im, Ketuvim. We go right into Nevi'im. What's the first book after? Yoshua. So, Vayi achre mot Moshe, Eved Hashem. Moshe is the servant of Hashem. He passed away. Vayomer Hashem el Yoshua. Moshe Avdi met. My servant Moshe passed. Now get up and cross this Jordan River. You and this nation into the land that I'm giving to the nation of Israel. Every place your feet will step there, I'm giving it to you as I promised to Moshe. Every step you're going to step, you walk, that's yours. Imagine somebody comes to you and say, today, listen, I have good news for you. Today it's your lucky day. You have one day to walk in Manhattan. Every place in Manhattan you walk, it's yours. What would happen? He ran the marathon. Moshe, enough. No, I want more. Well, you have half of Manhattan is yours already. Wait. After he finished everything, he's going north. Moshe, it's Harlem. I also want Harlem. Why? Every step, it's a billion dollars. It's Manhattan, you know, every building. So Hashem say, everywhere you're going to walk, automatically it's yours. So what the Arabs want from us? I don't get it. Don't they read the same Torah? They also know that's the book of God, no? I don't understand. Where is the truth? If you read it in the Torah and you say it's the book of God, and you read that God said to the Jews, every step you're going to step, it's already yours. Then everything that comes after, you stole it from us, finished. But we move on. After Yoshua, we're going to Shmuel. No, Shoftim. Okay, אחרי מות יהושע, מי יעלה לנו וכו'. טוב, that's שופטים. After that, שמואל. After that, מלאכים. After that, ישעיה. ירמיה. יחזקאל. After יחזקאל, חבקוק. מלאכי. Finished. The נביאים. Now we're going into the כתובים. But there's more prophets. But they come later, in the כתובים. כתובים, start. With the main thing of the night. What is it? Megillat Ruth. The scroll of Ruth. The Ashkenazim, they have a nice minhag. They read, not the standard, but the standard by the Ashkenazim never collapses. That's for sure. Only here, every 2 seconds, the standard refused to stand. The Ashkenazim have a very good minhag. They read every holiday a different Megillah. They have an actual original Megillah. And they read it with bracha. They take it out, they make bracha, and they read it. So they do it in the morning. The Sfaradim don't read it from the Megillah, therefore they don't say bracha. It's inside the tikkun of the night. One way or the other, it's a very good mitzvah to learn the story of Megillat Ruth because it connects to Shavuot. This is how the foundation of Mashiach, it comes from here. This famous story, in the time of the judges, b'shbime shfot ha-shoftim, there was hunger in the land, there's nothing to eat. It's not like today, if your country is bankrupt, like Argentina, or Greece, or Finland, all these countries who collapse, the people still had what to eat. Why? They called the United Nations. Hey, amigo, send us a little bit, you know, 1 million bags of flowers, you know, some water, some, you know, orange juice. No problem. The Red Cross, it's on the way. Back then, if there's nothing to eat, people are dying. Where are you going to get water? No rain, nothing to grow, no grains, no nothing. So either way, it's a big problem. So people are starving, so they're moving. Once there's nothing to eat, people migrate to another place where they can find food. And the food obviously is much more expensive. So what happened? There is a hunger in the land, and a person from Bethlehem is going to the fields of Moab, out of Israel, to the Goyim. Him and his wife and his two sons. He moved from Tel Aviv to New York. Business, Rabbi. In Israel, I cannot do any, no business. Let me move to America. Maybe over there I'll become rich. What's the name of the person? Elimelech. The name of his wife, Naomi. And the two sons, Mahlon and Chilion. That's their name. From Bethlehem. Vayavos de Moab, they came to Moab, to the field of Moab. And Elimelech died. Why he died? Why did you leave the Holy Land? He was Gdol Ador. He was a very big Chacham. If somebody like you leave Israel, what example are you going to set for the rest of the people? Hashem was angry at him, took him away. Naomi stayed a widow with her two sons. What did they do? What happened to Jews, Jewish family that leave Israel and move to San Francisco? Best case scenario, the two boys will marry Goyot. Or Goyim, depend. You know? So right away, one took Christine, the other one took Christina. So now they got married to two Goyot, Moaviot. What's their name, their real name? One Orpah and the second one Ruth. Two Goyot. They sit there for 10 years in San Francisco in Moab. And then Hashem got upset from them, no tshuva, no nothing. He lives with a goya, he doesn't care. I'm not interested in people like you. Right away, he took both of them. Mahlon and Kilion, both of them died. Vatishaer Aisha, she lost her husband, she lost her two sons. Vatishaer Aisha, Mishnei Eladea Umisha. She's a widow now, that's it. She stayed alone. Who stayed with her? The two goyot. That's it. ותקום היא וחלותיה, ותשוב משדה מואב, כי שמע בשדה מואב, כי פקד השם את עמו לתת להם לחם. She heard that the hunger finished, so now she's going back. We're going to get some food there. She went back, and the two goyot, they're following her. On the way back to the land of Judah, which is Israel. Naomi said to them, go back to your mother's house. You're done with me. What do you need me for? Your husband is dead. Go start yourself a new life. Hashem will have mercy on you. You were nice and kind to me. Hashem will be kind to you. Go find yourself rest. Find yourself a new husband. So they started to hug her and to kiss her. And they said, no, we're going with you back to your country. Naomi said, no, my daughters. Why? Go back. I don't have other sons to give you. I have nothing to offer you. That's it. Go. I'm old already. I cannot have more kids. Even if I get married, I doubt that I can have kids. Go. They cry and cry and cry. In the end, make long story short, Orpah went. And Ruth didn't give up. Ruth stuck with her. She said, your God is my God. Your country is my country. I'm with you. באשר תלכי אלך, I'm 100% with you, no matter how difficult it's going to be. When the place where you die, I'm going to die there. Where place where you're going to be buried, I'm going to be buried there. Only the death will separate between me and you. That's what she answered, that's what she told her. Orpah, few kisses, few hugs, we'll be in touch on Facebook, install Messenger, we'll be in touch. Don't forget to install Skype. I'll send you some love messages from time to time. Take care. Adios. Orpah went. I don't want to tell you what happened to her that night. She went to a club in Manhattan. She became pregnant. Who was born? Goliath. Goliath. Shem Irachem. Look at the difference between heaven and earth. One decision, changing the entire history. Goliath HaPlishti came from her. Ruth, she stuck with her. She went, converted, married the head of the Sanhedrin, the chief rabbi of the world, Boaz, and Mashiach came from her. And the standard collapsed. I wonder if it's only to me or when other speakers this also happened. We will find out later. So, imagine if Ruth will go with Orpah, how the story of Mashiach would be. One of the weirdest stories of the entire Tanakh, perhaps the weirdest out of all, is the story of Mashiach. How Mashiach came to the world. First weird thing is, it comes from an ex-Goya. Hashem couldn't find a Jewish from birth. He had to bring Ruth, that she came. No, Baruch Hashem. That's one thing. Second thing, that's not even the strange thing here. The strange thing, after a few generations, we get all the way to the time of Yehuda and Tamar. And Yehuda is going and see a woman. She pretends she's a prostitute on the street. And the Ramban said he had something not so clean in his mind, but she had 100% holy thing in her mind. And from something like this, then the Mashiach would come. She had twins. Look at the genealogy. All the way to David HaMelech, Mashiach came to the world from such a strange thing. Why is it? Why Hashem brought Mashiach to the world in the weirdest way? Why? The answer is, there is something that called the Satan Mekatreg. The Satan, it's like a prosecutor, like in court. When you go to the court, you have this annoying prosecutor. Every second he's trying to make your situation worse and bringing to the judge all kinds of things, giving him idea. He wants to bury you all the way. He's not settling on half. Oh, wait, Your Honor, I forgot. And you know, on this date he was over there and this. Okay, leave him alone. He already have 20 years in prison. No. Up. That's how they are. Same thing with Satan. He doesn't settle on something. He wants all the way. All the way. So what happened? The Satan is always mekatreg. If a neshama like this can come to the world, the savior of the nation of Israel, the Satan is scared. Why scared? Because the day Mashiach come, what happened to the Satan? Hashem will slaughter him. So it's very natural to know that the biggest enemy of the Satan is Mashiach. So what will he do? He put all his efforts to hurt Mashiach. So what did Hashem do? Tricked him. He brings Mashiach, because the angels, they cannot read the mind. They listen to what we say, and based on that, they react, the Satan. But he doesn't read the mind. So therefore, now he doesn't know where Mashiach will be born. He doesn't know. Paro also knows the savior of the Jewish nation is about to be born. But he didn't know which one, so he threw all the baby to the water. But they keep checking. Oh, the Savior is already in. That's why they put Moshe in the water, to confuse Paro. Oh, the Savior is already in the water. Okay, stop killing the baby. We got rid of him. This is the trick. Same thing over here, Hashem tricked the Satan. The Satan will never dream that Hashem agreed that Mashiach would come with such a forbidden relation between Judah and Tamar. He will never dream that from there Mashiach come. And then by the time it came, it was too late for him to do anything about it. So now, after we read Megillat Ruth, the whole story, there's a lot of secrets in it, obviously. Then we move on. Right after Megillat Ruth, we go after Megillat Ruth directly to Tehillim. Psalms. אשרי האיש אשר לא הלך בעצת רשעים. תהילים. We read some תהילים, not the whole תהילים, just part, very little part from תהילים. We move to Eov. Eov, it's in the Tanakh. Eov was a goy prophet. a Gentile, wasn't a Jew. Yishaya be'eretz utz Iyov shmo. Utam yashar yere Elokim v'sar mira. Righteous person, fearing God, is away away from everything bad. Tam, complete, innocent, and honest. If you want to know if a person is righteous, the main way to check a person if he's righteous is if he's honest. Remember, honest with money, honest with his speaking, honest with his money. He's deceiving, he's stealing, he takes things that is not his, he robbed people, he doesn't give them what he owes them, is not clean with money, then you know this person is not Yerei Shamayim. If you know this person is strictly, strictly strict when it comes to money, his hands is clean, then there is a chance that he's a big tzaddik. But without that, he's not a tzaddik. But Rabbi, Shomer Shabbat, you have to see how he pray. Shtuyot. He's not Yerei Shamayim, because if he steal from people, this is one of the sins that you cannot fix with tshuva. Chilul Shabbat, death penalty, you can fix by doing tshuva. Murder, death penalty, you can fix by doing tshuva. Even a married woman, eshet ish, karet, you can fix by doing tshuva. Everything you can fix by doing tshuva. Stealing, you cannot fix by doing tshuva. You must come back in reincarnation and pay back the money. You cannot go to heaven. Mi ya'ale be'ar Hashem, neki kapayim uvar levav. Only a person that his hands is clean from stealing. No. That's why there are very, very few over there. Most of the people don't go directly to heaven. Mi ya'ale be'ar Hashem, neki kapayim uvar levav. So the Torah testify on Yov, ishtam, yashar, straight, doesn't lie. You know how difficult it is not to lie? Try one day, one day. Hashem, today test me. Here, from sunset to sunset. 24, 25 hours. I will not say one lie. I will not hint a lie. I will not mislead a person. I will not deceive anyone. I will be 100% straight in everything. Try one day, you see how difficult it is. 25 hours conversation, people, where were you? We're waiting for you, why you came late? One day with the wife, with the children, with your partner, with your customers. One day without saying one lie. I know it sounds to you that it's a joke. Call me tomorrow night and tell me how it was. No white lies. White lies is black, black sometimes more than black white. You know? It's very difficult. Because sometimes a person doesn't even realize he's lying. You understand? Sometimes you can hide the truth. You don't lie. You just don't generate the truth. You come to a job interview. You are 30 years old now. You can come and say, by the way, I want to be 100% honest with you. When I was 16, I robbed a candy store. I was in the mood for an ice cream, so... But since then you became a rabbi. But as soon as they hear that you robbed the candy store, okay, we'll get back to you. Thank you for the information. Next time you find a job when your beard will be not white. You know? So not everything you have to run to say. But if they ask you, you can't lie. Big test, big nisayon. Very big nisayon. Next one, Mishlei. Now we're going to King Solomon. Mishlei. Next one, Kohelet. Shuv, King Solomon. Next one, Shir HaShirim. Song of Songs, Shlomo HaMelech. Then Megillat Echa, Yirmiyahu. Then Daniel, the book of Daniel. Then Esther, Megillat Esther. Then Ezra. Ezra. Then Divrei HaYamim. And then we finish the Tanakh. Right after we finish the Tanakh, what we do after that? Mishnayot. Some people skip the Mishnayot. Since we do Gemara, it's on the Mishnayot. Yeah, well, you know, some Mishnayot, a little bit from each Masechet, from each Seder, Some people, like I said, because the night is long and the time is very short, so they skip the Mishnayot. Then we go to the Gemarot. We do the Gemarot, Seder Moed, Seder Nezikim, you know, the Masachtot, Baba Metzia, Baba Batra. After we finish different parts from the Gemarot, then what comes after that? Taryag Mitzvot, 613 commandments. I made a series. What happened? The Russian came? Huh? Yeah, it became hot, no? One, 613 laws, 613 laws, 613 commandments. I made a whole series about it. If you want, I have some here, in Hebrew and in English, explaining all the 613 laws. I doubt that if you're going to have enough time between now and Shavuot to go over it. If not for this year, at least you know for the next year. I promise you one thing. Take any secular Jew in the world, Israel, America, Europe, ask him, can you name to me how many mitzvot you know, how many you think from the 613 he will be able to name? How many?
10.
Huh?
10.
Give them a little bit more credit. Maybe 20 mitzvot. 20 you will be able to know. Now you're going to go to people that are Baalei Tshuva 10 years. The beard is sweeping the floor when he walks. She's like the Rebbetzin of the neighborhood. She already teach Torah on the WhatsApp groups. The Rebbetzin of the WhatsApp. Tell her, Miss Rebbetzin, please tell us how many mitzvot you can name from Taryag Mitzvot. How many? Or the boy or the girl. Baalei Tshuva, 10 years. He's even going to learn Daf Yomi every day. How many mitzvot he'll be able to name? How many? Huh? Anybody here can stand up and say that he can name more than 50 mitzvot by heart? Do you understand now? Do I have to continue? Or you got the point? Right. Most of them do not apply today because we don't have Bet HaMikdash. Lots of different sacrifices, all the laws, all kinds of masrot that it's only in Eretz Israel. Fine. There's a lot of mitzvot. One's mitzvat Yovel, once every 50 years. Shemitah, once every 7 years. Regardless, a person must know Taryag Mitzvot. You don't have to know millions of details that connects to all of them. But the basic you have to know. A person has to know the basic. So I give you an example of what I'm talking about. First mitzvah in the Torah, Purvu. You have to get married and have children. What does it mean, children? At least a boy and a girl. What does it mean, a boy and a girl? A boy that can give birth, that he did not participate in a gay parade in Tel Aviv yesterday. Not somebody like that, and not a girl like that. A boy that is normal, and a girl that is normal. Today we can still call it normal, but the way the world is going down, one day we will be the not normal. But that's the way it is. What can we do? So, a boy that can give birth and a girl that can give birth. If later on, when they get married, you find out that they're unable to give birth, you didn't fulfill the mitzvah. You will only know that you actually fulfilled this mitzvah, that your boy and the girl gave birth. If you have 10 boys, you did not fulfill the mitzvah. 10 girls, you did not fulfill the mitzvah. One boy, one girl that are able to give birth, you have the mitzvah. If chas v'shalom, one of them died, the mitzvah went away from you. So it's only depend on reality, not on the actual moment. It's depend if you have a boy and a girl that continued your genealogy. That's called mitzvah pro-urvu. Women are not obligated. A woman is a partner of the man in everything. Without the woman, the man is not worth a lot. Kol ha-sharui belo isha, sharui belo bracha. That's the Gemara. I did not write it, so the man, please don't be offended. But a man is not worth that much without a woman. Besides the fact that she saves him from the sins and from all kinds of other problems, besides the fact that she cleans for him and cook for him and raises children and give him financial support sometimes and psychological support and somebody to open up the heart to and someone to trust. There's a lot of wonderful things about it. Besides all of that, there is one more thing the Gemara say, that the blessing in life doesn't come to a person that doesn't have a wife. Now I know in this generation we have an epidemic. What's the epidemic? A growing number of single boys and girls, more and more, are not getting married. There's different reasons why people don't get married. One reason, they just couldn't find the right one. They're very picky. Everybody wants Rachel, the wife of Rabbi Akiva. Less than that, don't call me Mr. Shadchan. And, you know, she wants minimum Rabbi Akiva. Less than that, don't talk. You know what, Rabbi Akiva not good enough for me. He's a Baal Tshuva. No, no, no. He's BT. BT. What? He's divorced with kids? And BT? And poor? And cleaning horses? You want to send me up with him? Don't worry, he's going to kindergarten to learn Aleph Bet tomorrow. imagine Shatran would offer you Rabbi Akiva. Huh? Imagine a Shatran would offer you a Shiduch with Rabbi Akiva. Before he would start his career, his business will be over. Right away. Hey, Moshe, you just put flyers yesterday and you put a nice ad. Why you already shut your office? I offered somebody, a divorced man with kids, cleaning horses, doesn't know Aleph Bet, never went to yeshiva, that today he started to go to kindergarten. So I lost my reputation. Right away. I always said Rabbi Akiva would not be accepted to any yeshiva in the world. No yeshiva would accept him. If Rabbi Akiva would be today, divorced, in his 40s, you know, doesn't know Aleph Bet, which yeshiva I will go to? Come, shalom, shalom kvod harav, yeshiva of Flatbush, yeshiva of Monsi, yeshiva of Lekwu, doesn't matter. He would come to the Rosh Yeshiva, hello, nice to meet you, yes, can I help you? What, did you bring the pizza, the lunch? No, I came to get accepted to the yeshiva. This is a pre-1A here. What do you mean you came to get accepted? Yeah, I want to learn Aleph Bet. I want to start becoming religious, you know, so I want to learn Aleph Bet. What he would say to him? It's not Shayach here. Little kids, they'll make fun. Hire a tutor. Hire a tutor, no? He wouldn't make it. Baruch Hashem, the world was different 2,000 years ago. So here is an example. A woman, she doesn't have an obligation to have kids. Of course, every woman wants kids. But let's say a woman didn't get married and she sat and learned Torah all her life. She reads Tehillim, she does Chesed. She didn't get married, she doesn't have kids. Did she violate the rules of Hashem? Technically, no. But reality-wise, yes. Not directly, but indirectly. Why? Because the reason Hashem put women in the world is erkenegdo. You have a purpose. So I put you in this world to help the men. You're avoiding a part of your purpose. Yes, you enjoy, you don't want the headache, fine. Well, that's not your purpose. Your purpose was in this world. Imagine if all the women say, since I don't have to have kids, let me go and read Tehillim all day, I don't want to go on Shiduchim. What would happen in the world? One generation will be over. So this is one example of Purvu. Then Mitzvat Brit Milah. Then not to eat Gid Anashe, when you slaughter the animal, there's a ligament in the back. Then mitzvah Kiddush HaChodesh, every month to announce Rosh Chodesh. Then to slaughter the sacrifice of Pesach in the 14th of Nisan. Then to eat the sacrifice of Pesach in the 15th day of Pesach at night. And then to clean all the chametz, to eat matzah, to sanctify every firstborn, to tell the story of the Exodus of Egypt and then Leil HaSeder, to redeem the firstborn of the donkeys. If you do not redeem, you have to put him to die. Not to eat the Pesach cooked or raw. You have to barbecue it only. Not to leave from the sacrifice of Pesach to the morning. Everybody must finish it What's not has to be burned. You don't live for tomorrow. Right away, Hashem educate us to count on Him. Confidence in Hashem. If you have a big lamb, you have maybe 100 pounds of meat, and you have only 20 or 30 people in your group, you have to register. You make a group. Not everyone is so popular. If everyone knows this person is angry like a wolf, nobody wants to be his guest in the night of Pesach. So how many people he has? Moshe, would you come? No, no, I already go to my mother-in-law. Yitzchak, would you come? No, I go to my cousin. Moshe, would you come? No, no, I go to the grandmother of my cousin. Everyone find him an excuse. So in the end, he has nobody, even his own children don't want to come. I remember one time a story. One man and his son went to Rav Steinman at 1 a.m. 1 a.m. at night. So they knock on the door. 1 a.m. a person was in his 90s back then. Today is Bli Ayin Hara 103. So they knock on the door. The wife opened the door. Can I help you? And they said, we have to meet the Rav. Is it really Pikuach Nefesh? They say yes. So she went to the Rav. He was sitting learning on, you know, he doesn't even have chairs. He has a bed. Sits on a bed, and that's how he learned. The bed that he sleeps with the table. You have to see his house. To go, if you ever want to be a real servant of Hashem, you have to go 1 minute to see the house of Rav Steinman, better than 1,000 lectures. The head of the Jewish world, and you have to see how he lived. Even though hundreds of millions of dollars went through his hands in the last 50 years. Big money from huge people. He could have done whatever he wants with that. Could have built himself a beautiful house and get a very juicy salary and a driver and the rest of the nonsense. He doesn't keep a penny for himself. A few times that he said that he didn't have $100 to give. This is it. Most simple possible way. So it's very interesting. Bli Ayin Hara, even reading glasses he doesn't have. 103 can read perfect, better than us, without reading glasses. Why? The eyes never looked at something that is forbidden in his whole life. They always stayed holy. 103 years of holiness. So they knock on his door. Okay, they let him in. They walk in. They sit with him 10, 20 minutes. They came out. So his wife asked him, what happened? Something happened to them? He said, the guy is the Askan, meaning politician. He wants to run to get elected. So he asked me if he should run or not. So the wife said, what's so urgent about it? He said for him it's very urgent. He cannot sleep. He's being very nervous. He has to make a decision. So she said, and what did you tell him? I told him not to run. So she said, so why did he go out with such a smile? He should have gone out upset. No? He had a dream. He wanted to be the new Donald Trump. He told him, no, forget about it. Don't go. Don't run. Why did he come out so happy? So he said to him, she asked him, what did you tell him that he came out so happy? He said, I told him that no one will vote for him. So she says, so why was he still happy if you told him such a thing? He said, because I told him no one would vote for you besides your son. And he was sure that even his son won't vote for him. So he was happy, oh, at least my son would vote for me. Today you don't know if your son would vote for you. The way the generation is, Hashem Yirachem. In a generation that boys call 911 on their fathers to get them arrested, everything is possible. One guy, he asked in his will, when he will die, to bury him with a coat and $5 in a pocket. So everybody was very curious, why did he write such a strange will? So they came to him and they said, tell me, why you want to be buried with a coat and $5 in a pocket? He said, one day there will be the resurrection of the dead. And when I get up, I want to be able to have a coat, and I want to have $5 that I'll be able to buy myself a hot coffee. Because maybe it will be in a winter, and knowing my children, I cannot count on them to have a coat and to have a cup of coffee. So the rabbi told him, you don't have to worry about it. You can be buried without it. If you have such kids, you won't resurrect the resurrection. That means you messed up. You messed up. You won't resurrect. That's a joke, of course. So obviously there are 613 laws, and it's not the time now, so we skip that. What comes right after that? The beautiful Midrash of the night. It's Midrash Rabbah on Parashat Yitro. This one I want to talk about. Today I prepared for you a nice surprise. After we finish this Midrash in 10-15 minutes, then I will ask a very dear speaker that came specially from Florida to give us a few words of Torah. Also brought you some of his CDs that just came out. And he's Baruch Hashem on the way up. We need precious and straight speakers that speaks the truth. In today's generation, we are having less and less speakers like this. So when finally you find somebody that always said the truth with honesty, without getting scared, giving his life to save souls, then you know the future, Bezrat Hashem, will be extremely bright. Soon we're going to have Rabbi Aaron Reuven giving us some words of encouragement. But before, just allow me to speak a few minutes about this Midrash, that at least when we read it at night, you know what we're speaking about. U'Moshe ala el ha'elokim. The neshama of Moshe Rabbeinu, the soul of Moshe Rabbeinu, went up to the body went up to the mountain, and the soul went upright to Shamayim. The body is on a mountain, and the soul went up to Shamayim. This is what it says, Alita lamarom shavita shevi. Mao alita, what does it mean? You went up to the heaven. Nidgashashta im ha-malachim. You were in contact with the angels up there in heaven. Nobody ever reached that level of going all the way up to where Moshe Rabbeinu went. How long were the commandments that Hashem gave to Moshe Rabbeinu? 6 tefachim, the orech. How much is a tefach? This is a tefach. What is it, 4 or 5 inches? This is a tefach, this is 2 tefachim, 3, 4, so 6, something like that, but very heavy stone and very expensive. 6 tefachim, 2 tefachim between one hand to another. When a person come to a country, the eyes of the people over there right away on him. Who is this stranger? What is he doing here? Why he came to our country? Moshe came up, it's not his territory over there. He comes to accept the Torah. The angel all got nervous. What a person that was born to a woman, to a human being, what does he have to do here? This is what it means, lakachta matanot ba'adam. You came to take a gift. Every angel eventually was forced to give him a gift. The angels, malachei asharet, when you say malachei asharet, sharet means servants, service. They are the customer service of Hashem. They do the job. Hashem send them on missions, sometimes positive, sometimes negative. The Malachi Asharet wanted to hurt Moshe Rabbeinu. Hashem made the face of Moshe Rabbeinu like the face of Avraham Avinu. Why? They give me a lot of respect to Avraham Avinu. And Hashem said to them, you're not embarrassed? This is the person you went down to eat by him. He fed you. You pretend you're Arabs, right? After you ate in his house, you want to hurt him? What is Hashem doing? He's tricking them? Huh? What is it, a comedy show? Hashem was allowed to do such thing? To fool the angels and make the face of Moshe Rabbeinu like Avraham and tell them this is the guy you ate by him? It's deceiving them. Ve'achaltem betoch beto. Amar HaKadosh Baruch Hu leMoshe, lo nitana lecha Torah ela bizchut Avraham. Why am I doing this? Why I make your face like Avraham? I want you to know that today you're getting the Torah thanks to Abraham. If it wouldn't be Abraham, you wouldn't be here. The only reason I took you out of Egypt is thanks to the swearing that I swore to Abraham Avinu. I swore to him that I make the covenant with his children, and today I'm keeping my word. And the only reason I made this world is to give my Torah. And the only way I give the Torah is to someone that deserves to get the Torah. The only ones that were deserved to get the Torah were Avraham, Yitzchak, and especially Yaakov, that all his children were tzaddikim. And from them I made them the nation of Israel, and today I'm giving you the Torah. But you should know that without Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov merit, you wouldn't be here, standing here, getting the Torah today. And Avraham, Agadol Sheba'anakim, the most giant among giants. And Hashem called Moshe to the mountain. What is the mountain? It's like the shoulders of the fathers. Moshe went up to the God and in the clouds, and he came down from the clouds. And this is what he said. Kotomar lebet Yaakov. Kotomar lebet Yaakov. Bet Yaakov is the women. That's why the yeshivot of the girls called Bet Yaakov. Why? Because there is a rule in the Torah, the house of the person, it's his wife. Isha bona, isha oreset. You want to know if there's blessing in the house? Look at the wife. Hashem irachem, materialistic, totally not modest, all day makeup and lashon hara, walking in the malls. Go see the house, you won't be surprised. Righteous, modest, classy, hardworking, praying, devotion, attachment to Hashem, not materialistic, go and check the house. The men contribute very little to the house. Anyway, it's not there. It's either at work or in yeshiva. Who builds the house? The wife, Bet Yaakov. That's why Hashem started with them. The message first to the women. Taged lebet Israel, that's the men. Tell every one of them what they're capable of hearing. Tell the women that the main thing I expect from them is to lead their children to learn Torah. That's the main thing that I want from a Jewish woman. Pushing her children to learn. But in a clever way, not by force. Force they always rebel against. Giving prizes, giving them love, talking to them, telling them stories, buying them the right books. With Adam, I first commanded Adam, and then Chava. And then Chava went and spoiled and destroyed my entire world. Now, I'm starting with the women, not with the men. First with the women now. If they will support the Torah, then there will be blessing. If not, nothing will help. The men by themselves will not be able to do it. You know, when Moshe Rabbeinu saw the Egyptian drowns in Parashat Beshalach, so Moshe started to sing to Hashem, Az Yashir Moshe Uvnei Israel. And then after that, his sister Miriam, she took the women, separate party, not mixed, separate, men over there, women all the way there, right? The women also dancing and jumping and singing. Aval Elon! No man is around. And they don't film it and put it on Facebook or on YouTube. You understand? So Miriam made a party for the women. Why not to make a Persian wedding? Everyone together. Huh? Rabbi, we family. Here you see. Moshe and Miriam. More family than this. And the women, I promise you, they were much more modest than today. They all carry a tent around themselves. So even if they come to a mixed wedding, anyway, you don't see anything, right? Imagine if you go to a wedding somewhere in the Middle East. All the women, you only see the eyes. So big deal, they move like this. There's nothing to see anyway. And it's still not allowed. Still not allowed. Imagine Hashem Yirachem with the way people dress today. So Miriam, when she made her song, she only took one verse from Moshe. Everything is different. One verse, same one. Which one? Sus ve'rochbo ramav hayam. Hashem drowned the horse and the one that was riding on a horse. Why she used that one? Because why the horse has to die? Because he is the support of the soldier. The Egyptians that ran after the Jews, without the horse, he couldn't hurt the Jews. So the horse became the base, the foundation. Without him, there's nothing you can do. Why Hashem treat the foundation exactly like the soldier? It should have been a separation. The soldier is separate and the horse is separate. No. When you're supporting someone, everything he does for good and for bad, you 100% you get. If he does good, the good goes to you as well. If he does bad, the bad goes to you as well. So when Miriam saw that, she realized, we the women are very lucky. We will support the men to learn Torah, and we get the reward. Very good, fair deal. That's why she took it, and she put it inside her song, inside the Torah. And after all this, obviously I cannot go over the entire Midrash. The conclusion of this Midrash, that Hashem said to Moshe, hold my chair and give them an answer, and Moshe said to the angels, what are you jealous with? Do you have parents that you have to respect them? Do you have Yetzer Hara that you have to fight against Yetzer Hara? Do you steal? Do you kill? What do you need Torah for? Torah, people that have bad traits, that's what they need. It's going to fix them. Why do you need the Torah that you're so uptight about it and you try to keep it here in Shamayim? And what happened in the end? Moshe brought down the Torah, and this is what we call Chag Shavuot. The conclusion, in Shavuot we do at least one dairy meal. There's a few ways to do it. One is, since we stay up all night, we pray Vatiki, Nets, sunrise. We start, like I said, about 10 to 5. We finish approximately 7 something. So when we get home, so we do a Kiddush, and we make a dairy meal, and then we go to sleep. And then after that, around noon, we make another meal, but this time meat, wine. That's one way to do it. Some people, the way they do it, they wait, they make one meal. They do dairy, they fold the table, they rinse their mouth, and they serve in the same meal, now meat. They eat meat, and then they do Birkat Hamazon. So in one meal, dairy first, rinsing them out, to changing the tablecloth, and going into the meat. Either way you want to do it, it's fine. One dairy meal, at least, is a memory of this, of the fact that after Moshe brought down the Torah, they realized that all the meat they prepared was not kosher, because they didn't slaughter it correctly. So they had to throw all the meat. And there was no time to slaughter more animals and put salt and get rid of the blood and clean the skin and cut the meat. It will take a whole day. So they ran quickly to make dairy food, and that's why we eat dairy food for 3,300 years. Any question before I'm stepping down and we have our guest that will give us a few words of encouragement? Any questions? Yes.
The Rav said before that in order for a person to do for a group, the children has to conceive.
Yes.
Let's say, for example, two boys, two girls, one of the boys and one of the girls conceive, and the other two doesn't. Is it still considered for a group?
Two girls conceived?
Oh, there's two girls, two
one
boys.
One
it's enough, I say. One, at least minimum one. And all the other one is extra. Yes. You need to have a boy and a girl in order for the mitzvah to count. Later, if you have grandchildren, the Gemara says, Bnei banim kebanim. So it counts like you have genealogy, but pro-ovu, you must have one boy and one girl that are able to give birth. We celebrate not necessarily the Luchos, we're celebrating the Torah, the Torah.
Mount Torah was a different Torah.
Right.
So
the second Luchos, after Moshe came down in 17 Betamuz, right, he saw the golden calf sin, so he broke the Ten Commandments. Then the second commandment was only 80 days later. After Hashem told him, Salachti kidvarecha, he brought it down, it was Yom Kippur. And the second commandment was not as great as the first one because the tablet were made by Moshe, not by Hashem. So meaning is a little bit less than the first one. So the question is why we celebrating Shavuot now and not on Yom Kippur, or at least one day after Yom Kippur? Good question. No, what's the answer?
I have an answer.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Louder.
The Jews, when they went out to try, they weren't on the level to know the sages of Torah. They only were on the level of Pshat. They were on the low level. What happened then? They sinned, and then Hashem had to change it to a Pshat, a lower level. So therefore, they celebrate what was the first move which should have been, which is Soy. They were not on the level. So therefore, it had to be changed. So you're right, but when Hashem said, when Moshe Ben said, Shimino Hanoi, right? Then listen to rebellious ones. Morim, listen to the words he says. Morim means, Hapashton and Morim Harod, the youngin, that you are the Pashton that don't learn
Shad. Zayt. Yes.
So you are Morim. But you could have had what should have been yours, which is it. So therefore, we celebrate the first one. That's why there's a source of Tikkun that night. Why it's Tikkun? Only Tanakh. You don't touch Tarish Bapeh. Because that is also
right, and we can add to that with permission from Rabbi Chaim Vital that the reason we celebrate Shavuot is because that's the first time we heard the voice of Hashem. It's never happened ever again. That's enough already. It's a holiday that Hashem came and spoke to us the first two commandments, and then when he was supposed to read the rest of the commandments, we couldn't hear it. But Hashem's plan was to read all the Ten Commandments to us in a public event. If this doesn't deserve to be a holiday, what else deserves? I want to welcome Rav Yaron Reuven. Bezrat Hashem, you're going to hear a lot from him in the future. Please come here, give us some words of encouragement before Matan Torah. Thank you very much. We'll see you next Tuesday, Bezrat Hashem. Thank you.
Thank you for coming for the Rav, but now you enjoy me, hopefully. B'shut HaRav, B'shut HaRav, and also B'shut HaRav, and you'll find out today why. Today, I want to cover a couple of small things, and hopefully you'll entertain me and actually listen. First, I'll say something small to add to what Kvod HaRav said and you said about Shavuot, just to add something, a little bit of Tom to that. It was my thought, individual thought, that I thought could be beautify the Torah for you a little bit. The second thing is some of you have seen my shiurim online, and many have been attracted to my personal story. I decided to leave millions of dollars on Wall Street, all for Torah. I was on Wall Street, I had a lot of money, I was on CNBC, CNN, Bloomberg, one of those types of people. My business card was gold, which is kind of interesting. And I left all of it for Torah and to do exactly what Kvod HaRav has been doing for 22 years. I joined the army. I want to tell you why. But the why that I've told already many times is not the why I'm going to tell you today. The why I'm going to tell you today is the story no one knows about Rabbi Mizrachi. It's my personal story, Rabbi Mizrachi. So as far as adding, and then obviously, the Musar Eskel and what we can learn from it and why it affects you, why you should even listen to it. So first and foremost, in regards to Shavuot, one of the main things that I got from it is that in reality, according to the Gemara Masechet Avodah Zarah, it is the most important day in history. Why? Because Chazal tells us that since Hashem came to all of the nation and offered them the Torah and they rejected it, all of the Malachim were very scared. Because they knew that if Am Yisrael rejects the Torah, Hashem will bring back the world to Tohu Vavohu. Will destroy the world. Why? Because the Torah is the purpose of this world. That's why Hashem created it 974 generations before He created the world. In essence, the Jewish people were, in essence, became Jewish because of the Torah. They weren't Jewish before it. Obviously, as you've learned from Rabbi Mizrachi many, many times, before the Torah, we were Israelim. Before that, we were Hebrews. But if someone else came to Mount Sinai, Chas v'Shalom, and accepted the Torah and we didn't, they would be the Jews. So in essence, the most important day in history is Shavuot. Now, why do we go over the Torah, or at least try? Because Hashem is trying to give us a little bit of a taste of the beauty of the Torah, but in reality, we can't finish it. We can't finish the Torah, and that's why in Pirkei Avot, you'll see that it's not your obligation to finish the Torah. Rabbi Eliezer ben Hurkanos said to Rabbi Akiva once, "You haven't come visit me in a long time. I have so much Torah to teach you." He says, "How much Torah do you have?" He says, "If all of the water was ink, and all of the trees were pens, and all of the land was paper, it wouldn't be enough to write down the Torah that I know. And that is not even a close amount to the real Torah." What's the real Torah? Well, I'll give you an understanding of what we have. Now, we got the Torah in Mount Sinai, but as Kvod Rav said, we got a little bit of a lower version after our sin, but we still got the Torah. The Torah later was given from generation to generation to 24,000 students of Rabbi Akiva. Unfortunately, all died. Then we were started all over again with 5 of Rabbi Akiva's students and Rabbi Akiva himself, all the way to today. But now, if you connect the holidays, if you go back to Pesach, it's a very important holiday. It's the Exodus. We left Egypt. We turned around history in one way that's never been done before and never will be done again. The slave turned into the master. And we go from Simcha to Simcha. Shavuot. But in the middle, we have a problem. In the middle, we have 34 days of disaster. The 24,000 students of Rabbi Akiva died during this time. So what's the connection? So during one of, I do a short chidush on WhatsApp, and it's on different places that people like, is usually 15 minutes. And I tried to connect the three things. Why did Hashem take us from Simcha to Simcha, but in the middle there's a disaster? Well, first off, He wanted to tell us that the purpose of us leaving Mitzrayim is to get the Torah. Whoever didn't want to get the Torah died. As we know, at least 80% of the Israelim died in Egypt. The Torah is later on. But in the middle, He wanted to explain to us what we actually have, because if we don't know what we have, we usually don't appreciate it. So the Torah that we got, according to Masechet Megillah, it says that we had 55 prophets, 48 males and 7 females in our Tanakh. But in history, we had over 1.2 million prophets. So we're missing a few. Their Torah was holy too. What happened to them? Hashem told us that their Torah was only relevant, their nevuah, their prophecy, actually, better said, their prophecy was only relevant to their generation. Which means that the 55 remaining prophets, whatever came out of their mouth, every single letter that's written in the Torah is relevant to every single generation until the end of time. So no one could ever say, like the Reforms and the Conservatives and any other wicked person in between, could never say, "Hey, no, this is not relevant to today. Today you're allowed to drive because Moses didn't have a car. You're allowed to drive on Shabbat. He didn't have a car, that's why he didn't drive." You can't say that. Why? Because if Hashem said their Torah, their nevuah, their prophecy is relevant for all time, that's it. But now, we only have their prophecy. We only have their part of the Torah out of the 1.2 million. So already we know we're missing a bunch. And out of those 55, we got down to 24,000 students. But out of the 24,000 students, we don't have all of their Torah. We only have the Torah of 6. Rabbi Akiva and his 5 students. So what would happen if Hashem said, you know what, it was about 700 of the greatest sages in history dying per day. We don't just mourn because we have nothing else to do. We mourn because we're missing their Torah. If you go on, for example, HebrewBooks.com, they have over 75,000 Hebrew books, holy books, for free. And it wants to download, read, and so on. And there's hundreds of thousands of different Sifrei Kodesh that you could learn from. The Torah is endless. But all of what we have today is just from six people. Which means that if Hashem would have skipped one day, said, you know what, today, I'm not going to kill the 700. So we'll have a Torah of 706. Imagine how much holiness this world would have. The beauty of it is that Hashem obviously knew that even what we have from the six, he has to practically beg us to read. But at least now you know that when you get to Shavuot, Hashem is trying to give you a message. I only took you out of Egypt for this Torah. It's the only reason. If you didn't want the Torah, I left you there and you died in the plague of darkness. The Makat darkness. You're going to get the Torah. But if I would have given it to you without you knowing how much it's worth, you'd get there, you'd say, yes. Nah, I like Harry Potter better. And you move along. But now that we know how much beauty we have from the little we have, we yearn for so much that we're missing. Now, one of the main things that about my personal story, I'll go through it in 5 minutes because there's not enough time. And then I'll go into the more interesting part about Rabbi Mizrachi. I've been telling myself that I'm going to say the story for years already, so. I came to the United States when I was 10 years old with my parents. I know 3 letters out of the alphabet, A, B, C, because that was in a cereal. In Israel, I got some Jewish education. We learned some basic Torah. But my development in the Hebrew language, Torah, or anything related to Judaism ended at the age of 10. As soon as we landed in America, we officially became goyim. We didn't convert, thank God, but we left everything. We just looked at everyone else, and all the other kids in the public school seemed so much cooler and so much more popular, I wanted to become just like them. This is why the Rav has been telling everyone for years that you cannot afford to send your kid to public school. It's not about just the teaching, which is zva already. It's not just that. It's the surrounding. Whether you teach him about the halachot of Shabbat every day after school or not is irrelevant. Once he's surrounded by that, he's not going to be able to hold on to it. He's not going to be able to. So I went to public school. I was considered a Talmid Chacham in public school. I took advanced placement classes and got college credit during junior high school. And during high school, I had honor roll. Nice experience in school. In fifth grade, I didn't know any English. In sixth grade, they sent me to special ed next to the kids that are disabled because I didn't speak the language. By eighth grade, I'm taking college courses. So it was pretty cool. But then we went to college for 1 year, went to Binghamton University, had a 3.9 GPA, which is nearly perfect, and then I dropped out. Why? It's a waste of time. The point of education is to teach you how to think. You don't need history, you don't need English if you just live in the world, surrounded by people. Most of the stuff they teach you in school is really a waste of time, unless you have a point. Unless you're going to be a doctor or an architect or you have some type of profession that you're going to be. If you're just going to get a communications degree, then you're just torturing your parents, charging them $50,000 a year for absolutely no reason. And this is what's happening generation after generation now, but just the bill keeps getting higher, where kids say, no, I'm going to college, Abba, I'm going to college. Where do you want to go? I'm going to Harvard. Abba gets a heart attack on the spot. My retirement account is gone. Abba, I just graduated Harvard. Oh, what did you graduate with? I have a communications degree. What are you going to do with it? Oh, I'm nothing. I'm just, I'm actually going to go back to delivering newspapers like I did in high school. So, I knew how to think. I already started working when I was a young kid. I had 3 jobs in high school, and I knew how to sell. I knew how to speak. So I left school, I started working. Initially, I started doing a few different things, and then eventually I got into the brokerage business. The brokerage business, I paid my dues for the first 3 years, meaning I made a lot of other people a lot of money except myself. But after September 11th, Baruch Hashem, I got a break. My boss screwed me, so I was able to finally be my own boss in a big company. 12 months later, approximately from the October of 2001 to November of 2002, so I guess 13 months later, I made $117,000 in 1 month and became the number one guy in the office. Another 9 months later, I became the number 3 producing broker in the country for a company with 5,000 brokers. I made my first $1 million. A year later, a few months later, I opened my own company, and then a bad month became $200,000 a month, sometimes $150,000 if I didn't work. And I eventually got to the point where I started getting some fame. I was on CNBC, I was on CNN, I was on Bloomberg, all types of newspapers. It was very, very popular, and all of a sudden I had a bunch of friends. I never had friends, but now I had friends. I had one friend for 25 years. Bezrat Hashem, he'll do tshuva one day. But other than that, I never had friends. But now I had friends. I had all this money, and all of them came with partners. So I gave all these friends jobs. They weren't really good, but I still hired them. Any miskin in the world came to me, I gave them a job. Some of these friends were religious. At least I thought they were. And my door was always open to people that want tzedakah, need help. I was so busy in making money that I usually would just ask the guy as soon as he starts talking and he tells me about the problem, and sometimes they're very emotional. I just tell him, how much does it cost? And they tell me how much it costs, and I just give them the check and they go away, and I go back to making money. And that was my world. I wasn't a bad guy, just I was busy. Donated a lot of money. And I was told by some rabbi that as long as I give tzedakah, everything is fine. Now, I'm not going to name any names, chas v'shalom, but I want to explain to everyone why the truth, the hard truth, is the only way. It's not some people yes, some people no, it's the only way. As the Rav says many, many times, if Hashem didn't want us to know it, He wouldn't write it in the Torah. The Torah is available to all of the nations, not just to us. Every week, at least 2 religious people, some rabbis, some just religious, would come and ask for tzedakah and also give us a Dvar Torah. The door was always open. Sometimes it was 3, sometimes it was 4 times a week, but nonetheless, at least 2. I had my office for about 15 years, but let's just make the math very simple. Throughout all of this time, I'm keeping basically no mitzvot, except giving tzedakah, but I don't even think that was really the highest. I just had so much, it wasn't relevant to what I had. I'm married to a non-Jew. I don't steal, but in general, that's not exactly the only avira that I'm doing. I'm not keeping Shabbat, kosher, only in the house. I think that pizza, as long as it doesn't have any meat, is okay. Little do I know that the same cheese that I'm eating at the non-kosher place has pig in it. It's actually one of the basic ingredients that you have in all non-kosher cheese. But anyway, no one's telling me anything. But every week they get tzedakah. But let's just do the math. 10 years, once a week. That means that any one of those religious people that came to my office had at least one shot every week to tell me something. Keep Shabbat. Maybe your wife should convert. Something. So if you do the math, it's 52 times a year, 520 times over 10 years. It's obviously much more than that. But if this politically correct strategy that people use was ever going to work, if it didn't work after 520 times, when's it supposed to work? When? I'm the failed experiment. I'm the one that showed that it doesn't work. You have to tell people the truth. So Hashem showed me the truth. When rabbis lied to me, Hashem showed me the truth. Only difference is it's a little more difficult. I'm not Moses, so he didn't speak to me through a burning bush. He spoke to me through hardship. In November of 2006, I had an elective surgery that went wrong. I went in healthy, I came out sick. But not sick like, I have a headache. Sick like, I'm dying. Screaming in pain, nonstop pain, the doctors didn't know what went wrong. My entire nervous system was shocked. No one knew what was happening. For the next 62 days, the most amount of consecutive sleep that I was able to have was 15 minutes, and I started bleeding from my eyes and every other place that has a hole. So I was dying. But then I guess Hashem had some mercy on me, Baruch Hashem. He said, all right, let's give him a shot. So I started coming back to life. Stopped screaming 24 hours a day, it was only 12. Took at least 20 painkillers a day, so it's less than the 50 that I just had a week before. Gan Eden. Went back to work, went back to making $3,000 an hour. Didn't do tshuva. 9 months later, there's a complication. I feel a pain in my leg, and I have to go to the emergency room, and I have my first of many, many surgeries. I have an internal infection that if I would have waited another hour, it would have exploded, gone into my blood system, and I would have died. I'm in an intensive care unit next to the dying people for the next 2 weeks. Morphine in my blood system at all times just to survive. Not fun. Okay, Hashem had more mercy on me, and I did leave the hospital, but 3 months later, I have another surgery. Another intensive care unit, more fun. Living in pain 24 hours a day. But now it's not pain just in the area I had the surgery, which is irrelevant. It's pain everywhere. From my neck all the way to the bottom of my feet, to the point where I wasn't able to walk anymore. I had to use a cane. So imagine this multimillionaire guy, 27-year-old, has about $20 million in the bank, but he's with a cane, and it takes him about 40 minutes to go from here to the door. How much is the money worth? Zero. So now I start losing money. I still didn't do tshuva. All the friends that I had all of a sudden became enemies, so they start stealing. I didn't really like them anymore. So they started stealing, they started cheating, started going to my competition with my clients. I'm a wounded animal, I can't defend myself. Little by little, things get worse and worse. I still don't get it. I went to over 50 different doctors, spent hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars trying everything and anything you can possibly try. When you have money, you can do anything you want. Or at least you think you can. It's worthless. It gets to the point where I actually become... Oh, the fly from your shiur came.
Yeah.
It came.
I wanted to say...
Baruch Hashem. Baruch
Hashem. But I didn't think because last Wednesday he didn't show up in Queens.
Ah, so he came here. Maybe he saw the flyer.
He sent me an email. What happened to the fly? I said, maybe he finished his tikkun.
He liked the Baruch Hashem. Baruch Hashem.
I said to myself, wow, he moved to here to
move. Yeah. He saw the flyer. The flyer was nice. My wife made us a nice flyer. So now I get to a point where I go to over 50 doctors and eventually get to a point where I become a science experiment. I actually become part of a study. And they start injecting stuff into me every single day, which makes me feel like dying. They injected ozone, which you don't really want to do. Steroids, same thing that the athletes take. Cost a lot of money, by the way. And everything and anything you can try. Nothing works. So once I heard that Hashem said, "Rofikol basal mafli la'asot." He's the healer. So, start paying attention. And I said, okay, these religious people are coming anyway. Let me see if one of them wants to teach me something. No one was really interested, so I went to a, there was strictly business. So I went to a class and started learning. Later on, it was just once a week, but still not doing tshuva. But the situation started getting worse and worse. I started losing millions and millions of dollars. Just as fast as it came, it started leaving. And then one day I have a miracle where my mom dials a wrong phone number in a different country, and it ends up being the only person that could help me. One day she calls, she saw me a few days before that. I was looking worse and worse. And she started, you know, Sephardic mom always has a book of rabbis, so she starts calling every single number she has. But for 2 hours, no one answers the phone. Eventually, some lady in Israel answers the phone. She asks for a certain Rav, and she says, I'm sorry, it's the wrong phone number. There's no such Rav. My mom breaks down to this strange lady. She starts crying hysterical. And Yishtabach Shem Olad, the lady says, Doris, which is my mother's name. So not only does this lady know her, but she can recognize her voice. My mom shocked and says, who are you? How do you know my name? She goes, I'm your niece. What's niece? Pnina. How did I reach you? I don't even have your phone number. I've never talked to you before in my life on the phone. Last time I talked to you was maybe 10 years ago, but I saw you in person. You were a little kid. She says, I don't know. But if Hashem sent you to me, then obviously there has to be a reason. Why are you crying? My son is sick, he's dying, he's this, he's that. I need some Rav to bless him. She says, well, listen, why don't you call my brother, Rav Efraim? He's connected to Rav Avadia, he lives two doors down, he's Tamid Chacham. Call him. So she calls Rav Efraim, he calls her back because he's in a kollel. At the same time that Rav Efraim is talking to her, I never knew that Rav Efraim exists. I never knew he existed. He was only a couple years old when I left Israel. We never talked. But anyway, my mom cries to him and tells him my sob story. And Rabbi Fahim says, does he speak Hebrew? She says, yeah, he speaks a little bit of Hebrew. She says, okay, can I call him? He goes, no, he won't talk to you. He doesn't talk to us barely. And at that very same moment, which I find out later, I decided to call my mom on the other line. And she answers the phone hysterical, crying. I tell her, what's wrong, Ima, what's wrong? She says, talk to him. Who? Talk to him, who? Ephraim, who's Ephraim Bichlal? Why are you crying about this Ephraim? What did he do? Just talk to him, he can help you. Okay, anyone can call me, just stop crying. So Rabbi Ephraim calls me, and he tells me the story of Judah and Tamar. Little do I know that he also knows that I'm married to a non-Jew. I like the story. It's the first time I ever heard the story. I was already in my late 20s. Not a very big compliment to my Torah knowledge at that point. And I like the story. So I start asking him questions. See if he answers. I ask him business questions, he answers. I ask him Torah question, he answers. But he doesn't just answer like, you'll ask me a question, I'll answer you, but I'll sometimes give you an answer with no source. He gives me a page number, a book, and an exact year was written, something amazing. Like, I thought I was smart, this guy is something out of this world. So we talked for an hour and 40 minutes. You're gonna miss your story.
No,
he knows the story, I'm just kidding. We talked for an hour and 40 minutes. It was a very nice conversation, and a week later he calls me at the same time, Thursday at 4 o'clock. We have a 3 hour conversation. I ask him questions, he gives me answers. With a source, and he makes me feel good. Every time I ask a question, he goes, oh, what a great question. Yo, so-and-so asked the same question 852 years ago. So I feel like, oh, yes, of course. Of course he asked the same question as me. So he tells me the answer. He tells me the source. And I just start coming up with new questions. I never even knew I had all these questions. For the next 9 months, every Thursday at 4 o'clock, we had an average call between 5 to 7 hours. Only questions and answers. Later on, he tells me that he used to pray before the call to know the answers. And I said, what do you mean to know the answers? You even know the page number and the guy and this and that. He goes, I didn't even know the questions. I never asked the questions you asked. I never cared about the stuff you did. But when you asked them, it was pretty good questions, and Hashem gave me the answers. Siyata Dishmaya is what we call it. The special Siyata Dishmaya you get when you do Kiruv. So now how does Rabbi Mizrachi get into it? So now, little by little, I start learning Torah with him. Everything I learn, I teach my wife, who for some strange reason always wanted me to be a religious Jew, even though she was not. And she would tell me to stay home for the holidays, and I'd tell her why. And when people would ask me, don't you want your wife to convert, have Jewish children? I said, I'm not doing it. Why should I tell her to do it? I'm not a hypocrite. Can't tell her to do something I'm not going to do. It's not fair. You can't just make somebody Jewish. It's either they want to be Jewish or not. You can't just make someone stop believing something. I used to make fun of the Christianity in general. I used to call it the remix. You know, they took our Torah and they mixed it up a little bit. And they made something new. It has mistakes in every single page, as every one of you has seen in the debate. It was a nice Kiddush Hashem that's eternal. I think that's what they're going to show Rabbi Mizrachi when he gets to his Olam Haba, or at least the first part of his Olam Haba. He's going to show him the debate. See, this is a good one. This got you the first few ones. So now, you can't just make somebody stop believing. But now, little by little, I'm learning Torah, and I'm realizing that I start to smell something funny. I start to smell the garbage that I'm in. See, the problem is, when you're part of the garbage, you don't smell anything. You can't smell anything, you're part of it. You start leaving with some Torah, you become a little bit, half of a percent of a percent of a percent kadosh, because you learn 7 hours a week, you start smelling it, something funny. So I start realizing there's something wrong with my picture. Maybe it is a problem. So I start learning more and more Torah, and I said, you know what? I guess my wife has to convert, but how do I get that? How do I get her to convert? So I tell her, you want to convert? She goes, no, I don't think you can. I said, no, I've heard somebody said you can convert. She goes, no, I don't think you can leave. Then it's a problem. It's this, it's that. Neither one of us knew anything. She knew Proverbs by heart, but she didn't know that conversion even existed. No one ever knew you could leave idol worship. We didn't even know it was idol worship. So now, I start learning about Christianity. Because I realize that you can't make someone stop believing something. You can't just say, listen, you believe XYZ for 30 years? Okay, stop. And replace it with this. It's not ice cream. You can't just exchange after you took a bite because the guy's really nice. You can't. So first you have to prove that it's wrong. And then you have to give them something good. The problem is that in between, there's nothing. There's an emptiness. And that's why most converts, when they actually get to that point, when they get to the point of nothing, before they know the Torah is true, 100% divine, there's a point of emptiness that's a disaster. Some of them really want to kill themselves during that time. Because you thought you had something, and now you just realized your entire life was fake. Everything you believed your entire life is nothing. It's just a mistake. It's almost like a Baal Tshuva, but not to the same extent. And now there's something else, but you're still not 100% sure. So now you don't really have anything. There's no purpose. It's a very, very difficult stage, which is the reason why Hashem has special treatment for them. And why they're mentioned in the Torah more than anything else. And why even in Amidah we mention them before we mention us. Convert that chooses Hashem is considered higher than a natural born Jew. But a righteous convert, not just any convert because they had a nice boyfriend from a Syrian family with a lot of money. So now, I start learning about Christianity, and I become obsessive. First rabbi I went to was Rabbi Tovia Singer. He was very good, speaks extremely fast, which was my style. I was a Wall Street guy. I trained over 130 different salesmen. I had all these people. That was my style. Fast, 150 miles an hour, telling me all these verses. It's amazing. I showed it to my wife after about 10 seconds, she said, okay, thank you very much, and not interested, he talks too fast. So then I had Rabbi Ephraim give me some proofs that he can find, because whatever I'm doing is not working. He writes a whole letter with proofs and proofs and proofs and proofs and proofs, and I read it to my wife. She's hysterical crying, and she says, no, thank you. I like the Torah, but it doesn't mean that I have to be Jewish. I can still keep the Torah. I continue to find different things. One day, after watching one video after another, I get a recommended video on YouTube. They have a part of this mitzvah, maybe. The debate. I said, oh, this looks interesting. So I press on a debate. I watch the debate. It's amazing. But there's one problem. Until now, I just thought that Christianity was second best. Like, I didn't know what I knew now. Like, now I've become obsessed with it for months and months and months and months, and I'm learning all these things, all these verses and everything else. But the debate made me realize that it's outright fake. It's not second best. It's outright idol worship. It's nothing. So now the most important person in my life is idol worshiping without even knowing it. Now it's not having her convert so it makes my situation a little better with Hashem. Now I have to save her. Now it's different. So, I show her the first part of the debate and I say, listen, you got to watch this thing. This is really good, because all this time we've been learning some Torah. She loves Torah. But again, you can't remove a belief. So I show her the first part of the debate. She struggles through the first one. After the first one, it's three parts. After the first one, she says, nah, I don't like that priest is a moron and the rabbi is arrogant. Just to let you know, by now, she's probably watched, I would say, at least 85 to 90% of all of Rabbi Mizrachi's lectures. She's a big tzaddikah. She's the only rabbi she watches. But initially, the Satan, she hated him. Hated, which is what the Satan does. Because this was the cure. So now, I argue with her and argue with her. Now, we've been together for many years at this point. I think we were together for maybe 8 or 9 years. Never had one fight. All of a sudden, since this conversion stuff came up, we have fights every single day. And now I'm arguing with her for about a week and a half just to watch part two. She watches part two. Unfortunately, similar conclusion. But there's a few good things in there that you can't have answers for. Why does it say 75 instead of 70 people came down to Egypt? Why is the Ma'arat Machpelah in the wrong location? Why? There's no answers. So now, we're starting to remove the Tameh. Because the first thing you have to do when you do Kiruv, the first thing you have to do when you help somebody learn the truth, is convince them and show them that they're wrong. It's irrelevant if you're right. If you're right and they feel they're right, you're still not going to win. First, you have to completely prove them wrong. You have to make them at least question themselves that maybe I'm wrong. Because as long as he thinks he's right, there's no reason for him to change. Okay, your Torah is good for you. Thank you very much. It's not for me. Because I think that what my lifestyle is, of driving to Beit Knesset, because my rabbi doesn't say anything, of giving a bar mitzvah to my dog because I saw it on YouTube, eating McDonald's whenever I want, I think it's fine. This is the problem. So you have to show them that they're wrong. That there's something wrong here. God said something else. He said, "Im bechukotai telechu." Says you have to take the mitzvot, you have to take the Torah everywhere. Not ta'asu, not just do them. You have to take them everywhere. When you're on vacation, you still have to be religious. When you go to Israel, you still have to be religious. When you move somewhere else, you have to be religious. You have to take the Torah with you everywhere. It's not optional. It's not a hobby. So now that I realize that getting to part three is not going to happen, and by the way, until this day, she never watched part three. But now we have some questions. So I start researching more and more, getting more questions. And she's at a point where she says, listen, I just need some type of sign from Hashem in the Torah. I believe the Torah is 100% true. Never question it in my life. But I need something from the Torah that tells me this is the right thing. Now Hashem told us in Sefer Dvarim, Deuteronomy, chapter 4, if you look for me with all of your heart and all of your soul, you'll find me. But not just if you look for me. Even after you've made all of the sins in the world, to the point where you worship the God of wood, the man-made God of wood, and the man-made God of stone, which, by the way, as we know from the Rav, is Christianity and Islam. Even after you make all of those sins, in chapter 4, verse 29, from there you will seek Hashem, your God, and you will find Him. If you search for Him with all your heart and all your soul. Which means if you want to find Hashem, you have to actually look. Not like you look for the cat behind the garbage, you don't find him, you say, okay, I'll buy a new one. You have to actually dedicate your life to finding Hashem. And that's what we started doing. So 24 hours a day we're looking for Hashem. 24 hours a day I'm learning Torah. I'm trying to sleep maybe 2-3 hours a day. I'm becoming very, very obsessive and a little bit of crazy. She's waking, you know, she goes to sleep, wakes up at a normal hour, and I'm like this, honey, look, I have more proofs. What? What do you want? I have more proofs. Look, this. So then one day Hashem, obviously, after enough tears, a lot of tears, a lot of prayers, a lot of arguments, Hashem finally sends his salvation. YouTube recommends another video. It's called Torah and Science. So now, the Torah and Science by itself should be a lecture. Just the story about what happened with Torah and Science. We watch, well, I tell, listen, Torah and Science, we actually have been reading Rabbi Zamir Cohen's book, every so often we read a few pages. You know, we like science, we like Torah, it's nice, it seems interesting. Okay, all right, fine, put it on already. Same arrogant guy, okay, fine, I'll read. We watch part one, there's three parts again. Part one, both of us at the end of it, amazed. We didn't know all this stuff existed. Really, this is what it says. We're looking at verses. We're showing something out of this world. It's the most amazing thing that you could ever imagine. The best experience ever. Like, wow, we have to watch part two. It's 2:00 in the morning. Click on part two. Doesn't work. Look for it somewhere else. Click on part two. Doesn't work. Satan's working overtime. Now I have a little bit of a scratch, just so you know. I'm the kind of person that reads the preface of a book and it says the project of Masorah Heritage Foundation and the names of all the people that contributed all the way to the end of the book. I read everything. I'm the guy they wrote it for. So now I think there's at least one guy left. Maybe somebody else reads it, but I think I'm the only guy. But anyway, I have to do things in order. A little bit of a scratch. So now part two doesn't work. We can't watch part three. But I'm seeing her. She's really interested. I'm like, you know what? Part one was so good. All right, you know what? Let's just watch part three. Watch part three. Now we know for sure the Torah is divine. There's no question at all. God is real. The Torah is the document. But we still have, we're missing something. Now she knows that there's a problem with Christianity. But she still didn't get the sign. She still didn't get to 100%. But she did get to emptiness. She got to nothing. So she prayed that night that Hashem either show her the sign, show her proof, give her something, or kill her. Because she doesn't want me to go to Gehinnom. Because she knows that if she stays with me, I'm going to Gehinnom, and she can't deal with the fact that she has to leave me. So that's what she prays for. Now her prayers, they actually get to Shamayim, hopefully mine get to the ceiling. The next morning, Hashem answers her. She wakes up, Tisha B'Av, horrible mood. And I finally found at 6 o'clock in the morning, lecture number 2 works. She's all angry. I'm like, honey, I got number two. She's okay, you know what? Fine. We watched number 1 and 2 and 1 and 3. He wasn't so bad this time, fine. I watched number two. Number 2, if anyone remembers, is when Rabbi Mizrachi talks about the Torah codes. But not only talks about the Torah codes, he talks about the very same chapter that I just read to you. Chapter 4 in Deuteronomy, right before, if you seek for Hashem, you'll find him. Before that, Hashem in verse 27 says, Hashem will scatter you among the people, and you will be left few in number among the nations where Hashem will lead you. There you will serve gods, the handiwork of man, of wood and stone, which do not see and do not hear and do not eat and do not smell. Here Rav Mizrachi showed, in the Hebrew obviously, which I'll read in a second, is the only place that you can actually see, not only that it's obvious who the false god of wood is, you don't need to be a genius to figure that one out, or the false god of stone is, which according to Christianity, they don't read this part apparently, because no one knows this. But in the Torah codes, you could actually find both of their names inside this verse. Ve'efitz Adonai etchem ba'amim ve'nish'artim etai מספר בגויים אשר ינהג אדוני אתכם שמה ועבדתם שם אלוהים מעשה ידי אדם עץ ואבן אשר לא יראון ולא ישמעון ולא יאכלון ולא יריחון. If you skip 49 letters, you go, you start from ve'efitz, the hey is the first letter, you skip 49 letters, you get to chaf, you skip 49 letters, I believe, if I remember correctly, 49 letters, and you get to the mem. That's Mecca. Same word, efitz, which is the first word. Hashem will scatter, meaning. You start with the yud. Skip 49 letters. You get to shama, which is shin. You skip 49 letters. You get to yishmeon, which is the same ending word that you found Mecca in, the mem. You find vav. Yimach shimo v'zichro. You find JC. He always wanted a place in the Torah. He goes, he got himself a place right next to idol worship. For me, it was pretty cool. I mean, I've seen some Torah codes before. But for her, it was everything. If there was a Bet Din next to her, she would convert on the spot. But not like a convert, like, listen, I'm not so sure. Maybe this, maybe that. Day one, everything. Kisui Rosh, Tzniut, learning, everything. Became the biggest tzedekah that I personally know. Kvod HaRav has been telling all of you for years, spend some time doing Kiruv. I left everything that I could possibly think of, dream of, and everything that I was good at, to make the biggest investment in my life, which is all of my time, do Kiruv. I wasn't a fool. I knew how to invest. I can go back to Wall Street and make money. But that's not what Hashem sent me for training. He sent me to Wall Street for 16 years to train, to teach me to speak, and to eventually create more Jews. We have a lot of businessmen in the world. We don't have enough Jews. Now that CD that someone gave, that person that sponsored this shul, the person that taped it, the person that's handing it out, changed my life. And for the last few years, Baruch Hashem, we've been doing Kiruv and trying to help people do tshuva. And Baruch Hashem and Be'ezrat Hashem, tomorrow one of my students is going to the Bet Din and converting. So, every one of us needs to know one thing. If you do Kiruv, and I'll finish it off with this, you could all take it into account. In Sefer Yirmiyah, the Jeremiah tells us, verse 15, 19. Hashem is telling us a little bit about Kiruv. Most of us have a hard time either doing tshuva. In the beginning, it's hard for us to build emunah. It's hard for us to change our surroundings. It's hard for us to connect 100%. It takes time. It takes effort. You have to sweat. You have to look for Hashem with all of your heart and all of your soul. He really meant it when he wrote it. So Hashem says, there is a little bit of help that I can give you if you do something small. לכן כה אמר אדוני, אם תשוב ואשיבך לפניי, תעמוד. ואם תוציא יקר מזולל, כפי תהיה. ישובו המה אליך ואתה, לא תשוב אליהם. Therefore, thus said Hashem, if you repent, I'll bring you back and let you stand before me. Meaning your tshuva is always accepted. Even if someone that's a machtia rabim, someone that's making other people sin, even though he doesn't have the same siyat d'ishmaya, as we learn from Pirkei Avot, he can still do tshuva. Tshuva is open for everyone. Even if he gets to a point of doing idol worship, he can still do tshuva. Obviously, he has to suffer and go through a tikkun, but nonetheless, tshuva is available, and Hashem says, once you finish your tshuva, you complete your tshuva, you'll stand right next to me. I'll accept you like all of my Jews, my entire nation. But if you bring forth an honorable person, meaning a righteous person, from a glutton, then you will be like my mouth. If you do tshuva, you'll stand next to me eventually. Complete your tshuva. It's a big deal. But if you help someone else do tshuva, kepitiye. What is you'll be like my mouth mean? The Midrash has many, many things about it, and so does the Gemara, and so does several other books. But I'll read only a couple of things to give you a little bit of understanding. The Midrash on Mizmor and on Tehilim 116 uses this verse. And it says, Hashem says to the Tzadikim, I am the creator, the ones that do Kiruv. I am the creator of the worlds and bring back the dead. You're the same. Your prayers, just like Rabbi Mizrachi has been telling us for many, many years, that the people in the Gemara that are named by name, they were able to revive the dead. It's not that they had power, but their prayers got a VIP treatment. Which means that if you spend time every day out of your busy schedule to help one of his children, whether it's by giving him a CD, helping a Kiruv rabbi that's changed my life and I'm sure many of yours or all of yours, supporting Kiruv, putting links if you're already on the internet, enough with the sports, and maybe put some links for the Shiurei Torah. You spend some time every day, not just once a week, once in a while, but every day doing something for Kiruv. Arrange Shiurim, get people to come, something. Hashem says, Kepitiye, you have a special deal. Your prayers that haven't been answered, you have the secret. Spend some time doing Kiruv. The Zohar says, if people knew the value of helping somebody do tshuva, they'd run around in the streets like crazy people looking for chilonim, looking for people that are not religious. In one of the drashot that Rabbi Avadia, Zecher Tzadik Livracha, said, he said, someone that's a tzaddik, that's born into a right family, goes to school, becomes a very righteous person, a big tzaddik, he gets to the Olam Haba, which is right next to Malachi Asharet, the angels of God. Gets right next to them. Nice place. But someone that's a star, meaning a star, Rav Avadia is using Sefer Daniel as a source in several other places. A star is someone that spends time doing Kiruv. He gets to a level higher than Malachi Asharet. He's the only one, there's only room for him. Only Kiruv people are there. It's a big deal. When I was in the Wall Street, the only thing I did is invest. That's all I knew. And I'm sure all of you know a little bit of Torah. I'm sure all of you know a few people that are not religious. And there's a very big disparagement between the religious and non-religious world. People that are religious think that the non-religious just don't want to do it. They don't realize that most of them just don't know. So the only thing I can tell you is that if you have some Torah knowledge, if you have some discs, if you have some money, if you have some time, if you have anything, if you care about Hashem, you have to spend 5 minutes a day doing Kiruv. 5 minutes. 5 minutes. You're not asking for an hour. You're not asking for anyone to become the next big darshan unless you can. But 5 minutes a day, do Kiruv. Because we have to save 15 million people. Rav Mizrachi can't do it by himself. I came to help and I can't do even a quarter of what he did. So we need some more. We need to build an army. If everyone spends 5 minutes a day sending discs, giving links out, sending text messages, to, you know, putting WhatsApp groups together, gathering shiurim, doing something. Kepitiye. Every one of your prayers, Be'ezrat Hashem, will be answered. And hopefully we can be sharing Olam Haba with Rav Mizrachi.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
אביב הלניה בן הקשיה אומר, רצה הקדוש ברוך הוא לזכות ישראל.